One of the cars I was most looking forward to hearing here at World Time Attack is Ryan Tuerck's V10 powered Supra. And saying I'm looking forward to hearing a car might seem like an unusual way of introducing it, but you absolutely need to hear this thing to believe it. Ryan, I mean, really the heart and soul of this car is that Judd V10. I want to go back a little bit. When you first had envisaged building this car, what was the dream? Was it always to have that V10 in it?
Yeah, for me, it took like maybe 10, 11 years for me to actually get this project off the ground. And it was more for me like the engine. That was always like, at that point, the goal in my motorsport career is like, I want one of these engines in a car and I want to drive it. I learned about it from watching the late George Plass's hill climb videos, and that's where I learned about Judd, and that was pretty much what sold me on it. And then for me, it wasn't like a specific chassis or car that I was going to go into. That was kind of the more of the afterthought, like whatever works out at that time, when and if I do get one of these engines on my hands, that'll get sorted later.
I'm also guessing with the selection of that engine, it wasn't necessarily about power and it was more about sound. It's no slouch, don't get me wrong, but it would be easier to make a more powerful turbo engine combination, wouldn't it?
Yeah, 100% would have been cheaper and a little bit easier and more cost effective to probably make like a six-cylinder or a four-cylinder turbo engine for sure.
Okay, so one of the things that I often see posted about this car is it's a Formula One engine. Now, while Judd do build Formula One engines, this specific engine is not a Formula One engine?
So, yeah, it is not. It's actually all derived from the Formula One era of engines that they made. But this is actually an endurance racing engine. So it was in a lot of the Le Mans cars. I think the team won in 99 Daytona with this Series 1 Judd V10. And I think they got another win somewhere else. I'm a little shaky on the history there, but that's really what this is built for. They punched it up to a 4-liter and made it turn RPMs down to 11,000.
Probably
16 and a half or whatever they were running their Formula One engines to at the time. And yeah, it just made it more of an endurance application.
Okay, so 4-liter, 11,000 RPM, naturally aspirated. And what sort of power does it produce?
Yeah, so it's making 630 at the rear wheels on a dyno jet dyno that we rolled it on. Yeah.
So potentially 650, 700 flywheel, yeah. Give or take, depending what you want to call the drivetrain loss.
It's rated by Judd at 730 at the flywheel.
Okay. In terms of getting hold of one of these engines, I mean, I guess if you've got a big enough checkbook, it's relatively easy, but they can't be a cheap engine. Can you give us some insight into how you went about getting your hands on one?
It was more, for me, it was like knowing about the engine and then searching, like, are these things even for sale, like used, you know? So I contacted Judd a couple different times in kind of my inexperience and eager attitude. And I was like, how much do these things cost? How much does this one cost? You know, I'm asking a lot of dumb newbie questions. And they came back with some pricing. I'm like, okay, well, at least I know what the benchmark is, you know? And then I had found this 0 mile used, but brand new refresh 0 mile engine on consignment on this website in the US. And it was a gentleman selling it based out of Texas, and he had a late model F1 program. I think he owned a Benetton that had been converted with the Judd motor, and this was his spare engine, and he was parting everything out. So the motor was on consignment. And I was like, well, this is probably the only shot I got at finding one of these things at this price, you know, which is probably half of what a brand new one would cost. So it was perfect timing because at that point I had found out that I was going to drive for Papadakis Racing the following year in Formula Drift. So the current race car that I had owned and was campaigning, I could sell that and come up with some cash to buy the engine. So
stars aligned.
Yeah, that's pretty much how it worked out. And got my hands on it, and then I started putting some proposals together and trying to sell the project to some sponsors.
So in terms of sort of maintenance, servicing, life expectancy of these engines, I mean, it's an exhibition car, it's not endurance racing. I'm guessing ultimately you're still not really putting a huge number of miles on it, but you know, what does the maintenance for an engine like this look like?
For us, it's really just changing the oil, making sure the temps on track are not going above what the engine actually comes with a big manual of all these specifications, even to build the headers properly, which is really cool. So just to try to stay within all those parameters and know, you know, to get the longest life expectancy we can out of it. That's really our goal in rebuild intervals at 3,000 Ks. So you have a decent amount of time. You're thinking time attack. If you're thinking in time attack weekend terms, you're probably only coming out of a weekend still under 100 miles on the track. So you'll get a couple seasons out of it, and we're hoping to get 3 to 4 seasons. And this is, I guess, the second year on track, really, and we've only been on track maybe 3-4 times max. So
In terms of the procedure for getting one of these up and running as well, because it's not like your road car where it's maybe snow on the ground outside, turn the key, starts up, and yeah. You drive it down to the shop. So talk us through the procedures. This is a bit more like how you would see an F1 car being prepared for a startup.
Yeah, so it takes about an hour for startup. We got to plug in the engine heater, or the water heater, and heat the coolant up. You don't have to do the oil. We do like to do the oil as well, just so it's you don't have to sit here idling the warm up for so long. So we'll do the oil as well. But you can't fire it up cold. There's no way.
And this is really all about just letting everything expand out so that the clearances inside the engine are where they should be, correct?
Yep. Everything's pretty tight in there. So they say, you gotta warm it up, get everything more to where it's supposed to be when it's actually running hot. Yeah.
And you mentioned that the engine was really the heart of the project, and then the chassis sort of came as a secondary. I mean, the A90 Supra is obviously a pretty well-proven platform at this point. Yep. How did that fall into place? Was there ever another chassis that was going to be potentially home to the Judd?
I don't know. When I got it, it was just like kind of a perfect storm for me, because my relationship with Toyota has been great, and they know I like to do projects. So when I got the motor, I was like, the Supra is the car, you know, that's just all the pieces aligned, and that's the chassis it was going to go into. Yeah.
All right. Let's talk about the rest of the car. So for a start, what have you got in the way of a transmission backing this engine?
Yeah. So we're running a Hollinger RD6 6-speed sequential transmission. Same one as that we ran in our pro FD car for about 5-6 years with phenomenal success. So we want to continue with a lot of the partners and parts that we have proven ourselves in our own race cars to keep them going in other ones. Yeah.
And then, of course, moving to the rear of the car, what have you got in there in the rear end?
So that actually came from Dominic, who built and fabricated the majority of this car. And he decided that we should do the Ford 8.8 rear end out of a Ford Explorer, like an independent rear suspension. And the reason we didn't go quick change, because there wasn't a lot of great differential options or no differential options. So for road racing, we wanted to have an option that we could tune in the rear differential. So the Ford 8.8 has almost infinite amount of ring and pinion ratios. So that was good. And then it's about 20-25 pounds lighter than a quick change as well. So
that's not insignificant.
Yeah. So focusing on the weight factor as well, it was kind of the easy one to go to.
In terms of the electronics, and then specifically around the tuning, I'm interested in how that works, because again, jumping in the deep end with an engine revving to 11,000 RPM, yeah, it's no mean feat. So talk us through that.
Yeah, the harness and all the harness stuff is all done by John Reed Racing, all the wiring and then the electronics package all from him. So MoTeC M150 ECU, PDM30, so controlling everything, and we've had great success so far.
Now, John's no stranger to our channel. We've got interviews with him. We've had him on our podcast as well. He's definitely one smart man when it comes to electronic packages. As I understand it as well, he remote tuned this?
No. John.
This is one of the ones he didn't remote tune.
Yeah. No, John made it a point. He was going to come down and tune this thing in person, even though it's there's no cam control. You know, there's not a lot of these extra things that you want to be around to tune. That he usually remotes tunes anyways, but you know, just the epic sound of this thing. He wanted to be in the car on the dyno tuning in person just to hear this thing.
Yeah, I mean, I can absolutely understand it. It's not too often you get to hear an engine that sounds like this.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of the rest of the chassis, you know, you're running this in a time attack style competition. That's gone from sort of strength to strength, and you know, we're seeing some pretty wild cars out there. Your power level, for a start, I would say, is probably a little too low to be competitive at the pointy end, but also not too wild in the aero package on this. Is that something that's up for further development, or where are you at with that?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of the direction of the project. It was more about the engine, then it was the chassis, and then it was like, this mix of like, okay, I think I'm going to do some drifting and some grip driving with it. And then we filmed the first video when it was completed about drifting. I was like, this is not a drift car. This engine is not a an engine used for drifting. So at that point, it was like, okay, the car's done. Now I want to transition it to grip driving and throw an aero package on it and all of that. And then it's just getting slow progress. Because once the project is kind of done, the funding is gone, and it's pretty much doing it, you know.
Now, obviously, you are well known or best known for drifting. And as you mentioned, you know, initially there was some drifting intended for this, and well, it has been drifted. But yep. I understand a little bit marginal in terms of the clutch that's fitted to it, and you don't want to beat up on that too hard because that in turn can affect the engine.
For sure. There's a couple things that we realized after getting 3/4 of the way done with the build project, and it was that Judd mentioned to us that. And all this is coming from actually an engine designer within Judd, a young gentleman named Bryn, who is into drifting himself. So he has been a massive, massive help in the completion of this project and making sure that we're steered down the right road and not making mistakes. So he mentioned that there is a very there's a lack of a thrust bearing in the crank because these engines are basically made to run off the start line and then you don't use the clutch ever. So for drifting in those long entries on a handbrake or something and you're freaking wrapping the engine up to 11,000 with the clutch in, it's probably not going to last that long. So our thing was, okay, it's a 5.5-inch clutch. It's already hard enough and very expensive doing it. So we did a 4-plate carbon from Tilton just to try to relieve a lot of the side load on the crank and have a lot more clamping force. So a low kind of a low pressure plate rating and then just stack plates to make it grab.
So essentially, you're going with a lightweight clutch pressure so that you're not putting as much stress on the thrust bearing or what is inside the engine in terms of thrust support. But then you've got to have multiple plates in order to actually get the torque handling capability.
Yep, exactly. And thankfully, the engine actually doesn't make much torque and the RPM range is about 7 to 11,000, which is great for track and grip driving.
I was going to ask about that RPM range. In terms of idle speed as well, I've heard of idle. It doesn't sound like it's sitting at sort of 900 RPM. What's it actually idle at?
I think we're idle around 2,200, 2,300.
It actually sounds much higher than that.
It does. I know. It's just like the when you fire it up, the sound just kind of engulfs every area that it's in. The other thing that we realized after getting to know this engine a little bit more is like everything is engineered for, you know, high RPM or for pretty much 7,000 up. So when you're idling, the oil pressure is so low, it's scary. The water system doesn't work very well. And all, you know, because all of those things are only engineered for more high RPM applications.
So what you're saying is that's not really much good for driving down to the shops and peak hour traffic.
Absolutely not.
Another element I'm interested in, fuel. Is there any special requirement for the type of fuel you have to run on this?
Yeah, and it's not as crazy as you think. It's just they say you can go actually as low as like a 98 octane. Yeah, and they recommend 100 octane from a supplier, but we sent over all of the data from VP. So we run an MS-109, which is a oxygenated, unleaded 109 octane, and they approved that, and that's why we're running that, yeah.
In terms of your relationship with Judd, I would have assumed that it would be difficult for a privateer with, you know, you're not running a prototype car or something like that to actually get support. It sounds like they've actually been really forthcoming.
They've been extremely helpful throughout the process of the project. And don't get me wrong, they are pay to play all the way, being a pro, you know, that level of an engineering company. And but they're all gearheads, man. They love what these engines do and love seeing where they go and what they do in the world as far as racing and motorsports. So
let's be honest, it's also got their name out in front of a massive market that may never have heard of them otherwise. So probably even if those customers might not necessarily have the funds right now, can't be a bad thing, right?
Absolutely not. Brand recognition is great, especially down the road. Maybe somebody strikes it rich somewhere and they're like, hey, I want a Judd engine too.
I'll put my hand up for one if I ever win Lotto. All right, Ryan, look, I really appreciate getting a rundown on the car. Like I said at the start, it's one of the cars that I really wanted to see in person. It sounds amazing on your Instagram, but there's nothing quite like hearing it in real life.
There's nothing compares online to being in person for sure. It's just, yeah.
We'll look forward to hearing it go down the front straight again during the weekend. Thanks again for your time.
Thank you, guys.
We'll be right back.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.